Tonight on League Life, we talk to Russell Packer, a rugby league radical, a man of extreme contrasts whose personal revolution was not only life-saving, but revolutionary for the game. A respected leader driving the cultural change at the West Tigers, Russell Packer is our very special guest tonight on League Life. Thank you very much for joining us. A very good evening to our League Life regulars, Lara Pitt, Jess Yates, Hannah Hollis, and a very warm welcome to our special guest tonight, Russell Packer. Thank you so much for joining us.
No, thanks for having me on.
Now, I mentioned it earlier, but you're one of the most intriguing and fascinating characters that we have in rugby league. You've had an unorthodox journey. You are very non-conformist. So what is it for you to challenge what people think it is to be a rugby league player with a criminal history but is also studying for the NBA, for an MBA?
Yeah, I guess it's, there's a lot of contradictions in all those things that you mentioned, but, I've never done things a conventional way. Normally, my way or the highway kind of approach to life. So, the journey that I've been on, it's been an interesting one, and I've learned a lot about myself, and it's kind of led me to the position I'm in now.
It has been an interesting one and a very challenging journey for you to get to this point. I want you to take us back to where it all started for you in Foxton, New Zealand. Just paint the picture for us about what that place is like to grow up in, the community that lives there and what your childhood was like there.
Got a nice little visual there. there's me there as a debater.
Baby Russell.
Yeah. I was quite a big kid, as you can see by the photos.
And the debating team, did you say?
Yeah, that's my... my rugby union team. So I played rugby union. Foxton's a small, rural town in New Zealand, farming industry, and a lot of people that just work hard for their living. And I grew up with three siblings in my house. And as I mentioned to you guys earlier, moved around a bit. My mum and dad broke up, a few times, and we moved away, which is quite common in New Zealand. As I get older, a lot of people have this similar stories. So, that those kind of experiences, shaped me, from a young age into some good characteristics, but also, picked up a few characteristics that ultimately, got me in trouble. So,
Your mum obviously was a big part to play, given your parents split up. But what characteristics did she try to instill? What kind of core values did she try to instill, and what kind of a kid were you? You said maybe not all of them rubbed off on you.
Yeah. Obviously, me and my siblings moved away, a few times. Was away from my dad for a couple of years at certain stages of my childhood. So, it was just my mum and me, my brother, and my two younger sisters. So kind of build a us against the world kind of mentality. So, carried that through, into my teenage years, and I guess a lot of people would probably say, combative or these kind of words, but I guess, from my experiences as a child, I had to be like that, to get through some of the experiences that I had to live through, and, had a lot of positives, but, like I said, also had a lot of, there was a few negatives there for me too, so...
You've got this the smarts, Russell. You were ducks of your school, and Foxton, given it's a staunch rugby union town, then how did you move into rugby league, and what did you want footy to mean for you then?
I originally started playing league, or being involved in rugby league, just for fitness for First 15 rugby union. So me and a few of my teammates from First 15 we went and trained with the local men's team, because where I'm from is predominantly rugby union, so there's limited opportunities to play league, and especially at age level. So we went and played in a men's team, and I had a trial and I loved it, and they all went back to the First 15 and I stayed in league. And
so you're 15 years old playing against fully grown men.
Yeah.
Wow.
And going and holding your own, I'd imagine.
And how big were you? How big were you when you were 15?
As you can see by those photos, I was quite a big boy. So I think I was about, I was over 110 kilos when I was 15. Wow. So I was big enough to, to mix it up with those guys.
And you went against the grain too, because ultimately everyone dreamt to be a rugby union player from your town. Ultimately, you chose league. You played for the Warriors for 6 seasons before you moved to Australia to play for Newcastle. Everyone knows that life changed significantly for you when you moved to Australia in one fateful night. When you look back now on that moment in time, what was happening in your life that led to you ultimately pleading guilty to assault?
Yeah, I did have a bit of ups and downs at the Warriors, and I left in 2013. I probably wasn't in the best state of mind when I did leave the club. Something that I do regret now, looking back, is something that's matured a bit. But the way I left, I was very young and immature, and a lot of things off the field affected me that year, and I didn't really realise it until I'd gone through all those hard stuff. Being in jail, I got time to look back and see how did I get into this position. And ultimately it was myself. I put myself in the position, but there was a lot of events throughout that year that probably put me in the frame of mind where I wasn't thinking the best, being injured, being out of playing football, and doing what I thought that's the only value I can add. When by playing, I have to play and do everything to get back on the field kind of mentality. So, put me in a bit of a dark mental space that year. And, my actions, I got myself into that incident, and, definitely took responsibility for it, and, worked hard to come out of it ever since.
We spoke to Judge Paul Conlon, and he said for a 23-year-old young man who had no prior violent charges, he was shocked to see that you would be handed jail time. And reports from that moment when you were led away by correctional officers said that you were in shock. You looked confused, because had you considered that you were going to go to jail?
No, I hadn't. My partner Lara had said it to me, but I guess in my nature I'm more of an optimistic person, and thought that punishment wouldn't be awaiting me. But I was definitely in shock. The advice I got from the lawyers that I had at the time mentioned nothing of full term imprisonment, but in saying that, all those circumstances, I look back on them now, and I think there was a real silver lining in that for me. Like I said about my combative nature as a child and doing things my own way, I've always been like that with learning. And my dad would tell me not to touch something hot, and I had to burn my hand to realise that he was telling the truth, that it was hot. So I think the silver lining out of all of that is that I learnt my own way. Even though I was very hard on my family, one thing I learned about myself is that, I was very selfish, very immature, and I was making a lot of decisions that put, my family in predicaments that they shouldn't have been. So, once I was honest with myself and saying that, it was very easy to let go of all those facts that you talk about, and just accept the position that I'd got myself in, and do my best to move out of it.
I imagine the journey through all of that and coming to those realisations were incredibly tough and challenging. Just take us through those early weeks when you were incarcerated, the emotions that you felt and how you coped, what you drew on to cope with what you were facing.
Yeah, it was a very tough time. I don't think anyone that's had their freedom taken off them would say that, it was a breeze. You have your down days and your up days, but one thing that really highlighted, through that phase of my life was how supportive my family was. My partner Lara, my kids, my extended family, and all the support that I got from them, really allowed me to, stay committed to getting out of jail and, trying to use rugby league as a vessel to turn my life around. And
when you're in jail for the whole year, was there a point where you realised you needed to change things about you? You obviously look back on it now and can see that, but what was the moment where the penny dropped? Do you remember that?
Yes, very clearly. I was I was in a farm jail, which was in Oberon at the time, and there's less fences and stuff around there, so you can see your visitors when they leave. And you know, it was around August, which is when my daughter's birthday is, and at the time she was just about to turn 4, and she asked me if I could come to her birthday party on the weekend. So, you know, that was probably, even though I'd gone through nearly 8 months of jail, that was like a real watershed moment for me, where I just thought, wow, this is impacting my kids, this is impacting my family, this isn't just me in jail, this is having an effect on people that are innocent to what I chose to do. So, you know, that was really hard that when that happened. And it just made me think about everything, how I got into this situation and what I needed to do to, you know, learn how to never put myself in a position like that again. So
the redemption of Russell Packer, it's a fascinating story. We'll take a quick break and we'll find out how far away you are from coming back for the West Tigers, who play the Warriors on this weekend. And that's a little bit before we have our premiership favourites go head-to-head at Jubilee.
Let's get this into perspective from the very beginning. This is the biggest game of rugby league since the grand final. The competition leading Dragons up against the Premiers, the kingpin Melbourne Storm. What an absolute pearler.
Somebody try and stop him!
So the week begins with Cameron Smith sitting in on Matty's panel, cool as a cucumber, laughing and carrying on like he's just an ordinary person, when we all know he's Superman in disguise.
Smith will take the shot. He's done it! He's done it! Cameron Smith!
Dun-da-da-da! Smith. Slater. Munster.
A brilliant piece of play.
Will Chambers. Vunivalu. And Addo Carr. How would you like a team full of that lot? Front and centre, with the fire-breathing Dragons. Widdop, Hunt, Aitken, can't he play? Graham, Frizzell, and a reborn Tarek Sims, and yes, Jack DeBellin.
That is exceptional rugby league!
DeBellin's grandfather, Fred, died in Cootamundra, a kangaroo, which is a fairly apt origin, since this kid's about to become a New South Wales Blue. Some days you just know something special's going to happen. 2 o'clock Sunday. Write it down. 2 o'clock Sunday. The game of the year so far. The Dragons and the Storm. Live. Right here on Fox League.
Did you think about getting a transplant or something like that? Like, is that possible?
Yeah, I don't know. I'm not too sure if that's a thing.
Would you help a fellow bunny out?
To be honest, Fletch, I'm absolutely terrified.
What happened next was probably the worst moment of my life.
Code Blue, I need help in here now. Brian! Stay with us, Brian!
Yes, it's heart-wrenching stuff from the boys. The Late Show with Matty Johns, that is following full-time on our Thursday Night League, which are the Broncos and the Bulldogs live from Suncorp Stadium. Welcome back. You are watching League Life on Fox League, and our very special guest tonight is Russell Packer. Russell, we talked a little bit before about your time in jail. So there was a time when you were lost from the game, and in fact you were banned from the NRL. So what did you have to do? Well, did you want to return to rugby league? And when you made that decision, what did you find that you had to do to prove it to the fans, to the code, to the coaches, that you deserved a second chance?
Yeah, that was obviously, I spent a year in jail, and then when I got out, you know, there was opportunity to go down to, you know, the Dragons, and me and my family moved to Wollongong, and then you know, I was unable to play in the NRL competition for the rest of that year. Probably similar to, you know, my experiences going into jail, there was another silver lining in that, and having to, you know, it allowed me to appreciate, you know, the role and the opportunity that I did have as a rugby league player. It made me realise that, you know, when you play this game, nothing should be taken for granted. But when you're young and you get a lot of things fast, you kind of forget that until you probably retire, or, you know, or you go through, you know.
Or it's taken away.
Yeah, or it's taken away through injury or something out, you know, something in your control or something out of your control, like retiring. So, you know, I learned a lot about myself that year, you know, obviously wanting to play but not having the ability to go out there, you know, made me appreciate, you know, what it actually means to be more than just a rugby league player. I think that's how I used to view myself, you know, prior to getting into trouble, was that I just played rugby league and that's all that mattered, how I played in the games, and what I did in my own life was my, you know, that was my business, and that's how I actually viewed it. But, you know, having that year away made me realise that, you know, we're definitely more than rugby league players. That's just a small part of what we do, and I think we've got the ability to, you know, be role models and to affect people's lives in ways that we probably don't even realise. So, yeah, that's how I definitely look at, you know, my role as a rugby league player now, is not just to play well for my team, but also, you know, definitely be a role model for not only my children and my family, but, you know, anyone else who's willing to watch me and look at me and say, you know, that's someone that, you know, I'd like to be like.
To get back into rugby league, you had to reset your mind, Russell. Can I ask what work you did on yourself to change the way that you think when you're in certain situations?
Yeah, when I did get out of jail, I'd never done counselling before, or I'd actually been and ticked the boxes, but I'd never committed to it. So, you know, that's probably the first time that I ever committed to it, because, as I said, the story about my daughter, I realised that I didn't know how to do it, because that's why, you know, I'd got in trouble and, you know, a lot of alcohol-related incidents as a child and, you know, throughout my adult life, and that I needed help to, you know, try and, you know, help myself. So once I realised that and asked, you know, was willing to ask for help, then it was easier for me to listen, trusted. So, but it was very hard for me, you know, as a young, immature person to say, look, I need some help and I might have to go and trust someone. So that's probably one of the issues that I had through my childhood, is, you know, I've always found it hard to trust people. So, and that's kind of what counselling is you have to tell them a lot of deep and emotional things, and I guess I had a lot of barriers up, and
you've got to spill your guts, don't
yeah,
you?
Yeah, yeah. So once I was, you know, willing to do that, then, you know, really helped me. So I've done that, you know, quite a lot throughout the year, and helped me to deal with a lot of the things that I hadn't been able to deal with that well, you know, prior to that.
You're now the poster boy for bad guys who've done good. How does that sit with you?
I'm impartial to it. It's just, that's the facts of what happened, you know. All my past is my past, and, you know, I'll never ever shy away from it. But I think what it does show is that if you do make mistakes, and that this game, although it can be harsh, it's equally as forgiving. And I'm no better person to say that, you know, I done the wrong thing, you know, I paid the price, and I've worked really hard to get back to the position that I'm in right now. So, you know, I definitely wouldn't have been able to do that without rugby league. Although we try to, you know, put blame on other people, ultimately we have to accept responsibility for the actions that we do. And I've been helped by so many people in rugby league, you know, from the NRL all the way down through the club down at the Dragons and West Tigers, people like, you know, Ivan. And rugby league is a very small community, so, you know, there was a lot of support there for me.
You are part of at the forefront of a cultural shift at the Tigers. You've been afforded a great opportunity there on a long-term deal. You mentioned Ivan Cleary. Just give us some insight into your relationship with him. what he means to you and that moment when he asked you to take on the captaincy for the Tigers?
Yeah, I was very honoured. I was a bit surprised, to be honest with you, because it was never something that I mentioned or he talked to me about. So, one, I was very honoured that not only Ivan, but, you know, other people that matter at the club viewed me as someone that, you know, they'd be comfortable to put that leadership role on, and definitely something that at my age and my life experience, it's one that I was more than happy to take.
Ivan says that you're smart, wild and crazy, all rolled into one, and that's why I wanted you to be the leader to drive this change. What do you enforce at training? Because you live by your own rules in terms of you live these standards every day. So how do you make sure the players don't step out of line?
Yeah, I've got a very good relationship with Ivan. I always have, and it's one built on trust and honesty. And I think that's probably a defining characteristic that I have, is that people that know me know that if they ask me a question, I'll generally give them the answer that I'm thinking about. And I think that's a great way to build a trusting relationship through honesty. And that's kind of what's happening at the West Tigers this year. From board level to our CEO to Ivan, and all the way down to our players, there's an open and honest relationship building that's going on there. And I think that's paying off. We're seeing some of the fruits of that labour come out in our performances. So it's something that's never easy to do, is trust people, open up to them. But I think there's a lot of benefits when you can do that.
It's a whole new era at the West Tigers. It's phenomenal to watch so far this season. Now, how far away are you with your knee? You've missed the last few weeks. When are we going to see you back?
Yeah, hopefully our next game out in Leichhardt, so circle that game. But, if my knee doesn't respond, so be it. But, I'd love to, experience what it feels like to play at Leichhardt, like suburban ground for the West Tigers, something that I'm aiming for. But like I said, if my knee's no good, my knee's no good, and go for the next week. But
which is the Dragons.
Yeah.
I bet you'll be doing everything you can to be back then in time for that. Well, the West Tigers travel to Mount Smart Stadium to take on the Warriors. Russell Packer, thank you so much. Really appreciate it. You have such a unique story in the game and you have such a powerful voice. So thank you so much for sharing it with us on LeagueLife tonight.
Thank you.
All right. Do not forget, following us every Wednesday is The Greatest with Mick Ennis.
Thanks, girls. Well, tonight we're looking at an absolute classic. 2002, the Dogs up against the Knights, an El Magic sideline conversion.
The Bulldogs were a very good team, consistent in all areas, but more importantly, they had Hazem, and he was just shooting the lights out that year, and we couldn't bring Hazem into the game and having a result hinging on a Hazem El Masri kick, and lo and behold, 79th minute and 59 seconds in, he's got his chance to win the game for him, and outstanding kick of the ball, and like we said, we didn't even watch it, just we knew it was going over.
Ben Hunt's a very relaxed bloke. He's pretty quiet, to be honest, but he's great to have around the club.
What a play from Hunt. He is in great form, Ben Hunt.
When you're a halfback within the team, when he speaks, people certainly listen, and like I said, we get along really, really well, and like I said, he's a pretty laid-back character, which is good. As a player, has put definitely stability in the number seven role. Yeah, look, he's played at the highest level, Origin, played for his country, and he's played a number of first grade games now. So he's certainly brought a good kicking game, good direction, and it's certainly been beneficial the early stage of the season.
Hunt again, straight up the middle. Winnup supports on the outside. Now he toes it again. Gareth Winnup, well played, son.
We're going along okay at the moment. Certainly a lot of improvement left yet.
They are the tactical twosome driving the Dragon success so far in 2018. St George Illawarra up against the Storm. Jubilee, that is on your KFC Sunday ticket, hosted by a fanatical Lara Pitt. So that'll be some animated hosting on your Sunday afternoon. All right, we are flying here on our LeagueLife tipping. We're up to $3,700. Let's find out who this week's guest tipster is.
Hey, girls, loving the show this year. Thanks for having me as your guest tipster for round 9. Here are my tips. We've got the Broncos via the Bulldogs. I'm tipping the Bulldogs up there at Suncorp Stadium. The Rabbitohs to beat the Knights. Panthers and Cowboys, I think the Panthers are going to win that. Raiders v Titans, I'm going to take the Raiders at home advantage. The Warriors to beat West Tigers. Parramatta to continue their winning ways and beat the Sharks. I think the Dragons will be too good for a hot storm at the moment. And Roosters to beat a depleted Seagulls to finish the round. Good luck, girls. Have a great night.
Big thank you to Sam Burgess there. Ladies, thank you very much. That is League Life for tonight.